We also began to see the development of a diaspora in San Francisco, something that had been happening since the very beginning, but it was very unique, was the way that people began to arrive really kind of in droves. And many little pockets, many little communities formed around the city. I wish Oscar Pinarando were here tonight. Sadly, he couldn't make it. He was taken ill. He's got the flu. But his story, The King Butcher of Bristol Bay, really speaks of the hopes of immigrants and of some of the things that actually happen when people arrive and, even with the best intentions, become displaced. By the time we enter the 70s, we see successive wave upon wave of generation pass over, of gentrification pass over the city. And landmarks which were very symbolic, like Playland by the beach, various hotels where immigrants and where, you know, labor organizers and workers and many people kind of congregated, suffered arson. I can think back to the International Hotel and the evictions that took place there in the 70s. So in a way, the kind of subversion of the commons by the kind of a plutocratic drive, the way the Vietnam vets returned and were displaced, these things all kind of created the stage for stories such as Bill Prandini's Souls Burning. And even though I know San Francisco is a place really where people have come to realize their hopes and perhaps to reinvent themselves, it's also a place really where they have sometimes come to unravel. And David Corbett's stories really speak to that. David is no stranger to noir, having worked for over 15 years as a private investigator. This really comes through in his stories, which are really beautifully devious in their sensibility. He's also really, I think, one of the most intelligent writers writing in the hard-boiled vein. He's written three novels, The Devil's Redhead, Done for a Dime, and The Blood of Paradise, which was proclaimed the one of the top 10 mystery thrillers of 2007 by the Washington Post. Recently, he has finished a story called Pretty Little Parasite, which was included in Las Vegas Noir and selected for inclusion in the Best American Mystery Stories of 2009. Welcome, David Corbett.
I always love Peter's patter when he starts these things. I kind of go, God, that's really interesting what he's saying, but it has nothing to do with why I wrote this story. And this story was actually based on a case that my late wife and I worked on. She was an estate planning and probate lawyer. So it has its one of its feet in fact. But I transported it to Hunter's Point because that was the area I was asked to write about in the first San Francisco Noir. And I was chosen because I am so conspicuously African-American. And but I did have a story, and it did fit that that realm. And as Peter pointed out, the first San Francisco Noir was really based on neighborhood, and the second one goes by decades. So given the fact that many of the contributors to San Francisco Noir just happened to be dead, it was kind of hard to round them up for reading, so they sort of recruited some of us from Brooklyn. Indulge me. I'm part of a larger picture, but not the more specific one we're celebrating tonight. The name of the story is called It Can Happen. Pilgrim watched as, just outside his bedroom door, Lorene handed Robert $50 and told him she wanted to visit personal with her ex-husband for a spell. Robert was Pilgrim's nurse. He'd been a wrestler in college. You had to be strong to heft a paralyzed man in and out of bed, and worked sometimes now as a bouncer on his off hours. Robert glanced back toward the bedroom for approval, and Pilgrim gave his nod. The big man pocketed the money, donned his hat, and walked out the door in his whites, not bothering with his coat despite the cold. Pilgrim liked that about Robert, his strength, his vigor, his indifference to life's little bothers. Maybe liked wasn't quite the word. Envied was the word. He lay back in bed and waited for Lorene to rejoin him. His room was the largest in the cramped, dreary house, and bare except for the $20,000 wheelchair gathering dust in the corner, the large screen TV he was so very tired of watching, an armchair for visitors with a single lamp beside it, and the centerpiece, the mechanical bed, a hospital model, pulled it up, because he didn't just lie flat all day. Lorraine took a position bedside and crossed her arms. She was a pretty, short, ample, strong woman. "Don't make me go off on you." Pilgrim tilted his head to see her, eyes glazed. Every 10 minutes or so, someone needed to wipe the fluid away. It was a new problem, the tear ducts. 3 years now since the accident, reduced to dead weight from the neck down, followed by organs failing, musty skin, powdery hair, his body is in a slow but inexorable race with his mind to the grave. He was 43 years old. In a scratchy whisper, he said, "I got my eyes and ears out there." "Corella?" Their daughter, Corella the Giver, Lorraine called her, not kindly. "You've been buying things," he said. "Furniture, a crime now. Things you can't afford, not by the widest stretch. Ain't your business, Pilgrim. My home we're talking about." She pressed her finger against her breastbone. "Mine." Lorraine lived in a renovated Queen Anne Victorian in the Excelsior District in San Francisco. Hardly an exclusive area, but grand next to Hunter's Point, where Pilgrim remained, living in the same house he'd lived in on a warehouseman's salary, barely more than a shack. Pilgrim bought the Excelsior house after his accident when he came into money through the legal settlement. He was broadsided by a semi when his brakes failed, a design defect, on his lightweight pickup. Lorraine stood by him till the money came through, then filed for divorce, saying she was still young. She needed a real husband. Actually, the word she used was functional. The divorce was uglier than some, less so than most. The major compromise concerned the Victorian. He gave her a living estate. It was her residence until she died, but it stayed in his name. He needed that. Lorraine would have her lovers, the men would come and go, but he'd still have that cord connecting them. His love, her guilt. His money, her wants. He got $12,000 a month from the annuity the truck manufacturer set up. Half of that went to pay Lorraine's mortgage. The rest got eaten up by medical bills, 24-hour care, medicine, food, utilities. He had no choice but to stay here in this ugly, decrepit, shameful house. "No, your problem, Pilgrim. You don't get out. Dust off that damn wheelchair and catch pneumonia. Wrap your damn self up." "Who is he, Lorraine?" She cocked her head. "Who you mean?" "The man in the house I pay for." Lorraine put her hands on her hips and rocked a little back and forth. "No, no, Pilgrim. You and me, we got an understanding. I don't know what Corella's been saying. I know you got men. That's not the point here. You take this one in. You got no say, Pilgrim. Even folks at Corella's church know about it. Reverend Williams, he calls himself. Slick as a frog's ass. I ain't listening to this. All AIDS this and Africa that. But he's running from trouble in Florida somewhere, down around Tampa. That's church gossip, Pilgrim. Raymond never even been to Tampa. Now you're spending money hand over fist. Where's it coming from, Lorraine? Phony charity? Pass the basket? Raymond? No, that wouldn't pay the freight, way I hear you redone that house. What you up to, Lorraine? You know I'll find out." Finally, fear darkened her eyes. He wanted to ask her, "What do you expect? Take away a man's body, he still has his heart. Mess with his heart, though. There's nothing left but the hate, and the hate builds."